Thanks, Wendy. First of all, I want to, on behalf of the Board of Directors of the Health Nexus, to welcome you into the 2018 Best Start Resource Center Conference. You don't get a lot of opportunity to see the people who participate in our programs, and so it's great to be here with you this morning. We certainly applaud the work that you do with expectant parents, parents and children. Let me say that it's really important to me because I am a father of six children and I'm now enjoying about seven grandchildren. So I have a little bit of experience with child development in my own way. This morning our address is titled Beyond Information and Advice, How to Help Parents Nurture and Raise Their Children. Our speaker this morning is Dr. Barry Zuckerman. I have to apologize because I spent about half an hour last evening putting together a nice little introduction this morning, and then my wife took my car, which I one of those opportunities that you have in life to enjoy life that way. Dr. Zuckerman is a national and international expert and leader in child development. He is a professor of pediatrics at Boston University School of Medicine and the Boston Medical Center. He and his colleagues have transformed pediatric care for low-income children through programs like Reach Out and READ, medical league partnerships for children, and things like Healthy Steps and Healthy Leads. He has published over 250 scientific articles, so he's a very strong writer and has co-edited over 8 or 9 books, depending on which resume you read at this point, I noticed last evening. So many awards he has received, and I think this morning we have an excellent speaker that had started our program this morning. So I'll give you Dr. Barry Zuckerman.
Wonder about how we talk about public policy. It means plenty to us, But as we communicate to people, what are the best words for the public to talk about what we believe is important? I throw that out as a challenge. I've not come up with anything myself, but I think words are important, and sometimes you need new words to describe either new things, or sometimes new words to describe old things, to move things along. Maybe your generation can come up with something. I want to quickly review with you what I'll call the biologic evidence of around parenting, what young children need. I think many of you know it, but before I get into the information, it would be helpful to think about where it comes from and what we know. To oversimplify it, the brain is the key, and there's strategies that can nurture and stimulate the brain, and there's strategies of adverse experiences. And that really basically gives you not only child outcomes, but adult outcomes. And, I also threw in things like, neurotoxic exposure. But mostly it's a social environment that we're working with, and we have to work on the nutrition and other aspects too. So this is a slide. I think many of you have seen it. It's on the left-hand side is what the brain looks like at birth. Those are called brain cells, and those little branches from it are called dendrites. So the brain is not, the brain cells are not really connected to each other at birth. And so it would be like having telephones in Toronto and telephones in Boston, except they couldn't communicate. So the telephones are there, they're just not communicating. What happens over time, first by genetics, is these brain cells get connected. So it really, the maximum connection actually occurs in 1 year, but you can see it's 6 years. The number of brain cells are the same in those pictures. What's different is the number of connections, okay? And at 14 years of age, same thing, the brain number of cells are the same, but the connections are different. Now you'll notice that there are less connections at 14 years than at 6 years. We all know you go downhill at some point, but you wouldn't think that it's gonna be at 14. What really happens is a process called pruning. Those cells that are used stay connected. Those who aren't used, wither away. And this is an oversimplification. It'd be no different like exercising your muscles. If you exercise certain muscles, they'll get bigger and stronger. If you don't, they won't. So culture really matters. So when you look at some cultures, and you think about South and Central America, where you see mothers teach their young children to weave, somewhere in the Middle East. If you ever watch weavers, how quickly they can move their hands, coordination with their eyes, something I can't do. But those brain cells that are involved in that are practiced and are maintained, so they do that their whole life. I don't think I could learn that at this point. On the other hand, certain analytic strategies that I've been trained with my brain connections can do that. So it's a real sense of what you practice and what's part of your culture. If your culture emphasizes the weaving, then your brain cells will do that. My favorite study was an imaging study. They did imaging studies of violinists, and they showed their hands that quickly move on the violin strings. And the place in the brain for the violinist where those related to those fingers was bigger in the place in the brain than non-violinists. So it's called use it or lose it. That's the importance of both culture, because culture dictates what is important to survive. What's interesting now, we're in a social transition. Because in the past, culture might be, well, we want, parents' role was to socialize the children, to teach them to be respectful, to have them do chores. But they, it was working on manual jobs, keeping the house clean, working on a farm. But now that we have a social transformation of a lot of service jobs, people need different skills. So what worked culturally in the past may not work now, and that's why we emphasize, a lot of the early education, and I will be talking more about that. So that's the stimulation part of the brain. The other part is adverse experiences. Every time your body has an adverse experience, you get this shot of cortisol, steroids, in your body that helps your body deal with it. It's a flight or fight mechanism. It's normal, and actually the steroids go up early in the morning before you wake. It's almost like a shot of coffee that you need to get your yourself going. And those of you who have jobs which are multiply stressful, or you're a parent who's multiply stressful, you can get this, you know, hit of these steroids, you know, going regularly. That in itself is not bad, but when those steroids come because of a lot of significant adverse events or traumas that occur for high durations, what you see is that bottom, you lose the rhythmicity of the steroids going up and down, which is normal, it goes up and stays up. And that throws off your whole dysregulation of your body system, both in terms of behavior, some of your immunologic function, some of your cardiovascular function, and more specifically, things we've learned from post-traumatic stress, which, you know, was something that we know that people in the armed services suffered, but now we also know that rape victims and other victims suffer. You see, that's the hippocampus part of the brain there, which is part of memory. And what happens with these significant and recurrent stresses is when you get these steroids, they can literally kill these cells of the hippocampus. So people who have chronic stress, the hippocampus was smaller, which is consistent with what we know about post-traumatic stress disorder, that memories impaired as well as other things. What I'm trying to do is showing the relation between brain and behavior and social environment, just to lay out the science of it. And here's a picture of what happened to those dendritic branches under stress. You can see actual the physical changes. Now these happen at the extreme. Most people can deal with a fair amount of stress, particularly if they have some buffers, like adults and parents who can do that. They certainly don't need the most enriched environment, but they need something. And it's those two extremes of too much stress or lack of enrichment that really we're all working on and supporting a lot of parents in between that. Now, how many people here have seen the still face video? No, good. For those of you who haven't, hopefully it'll be a treat. So I just showed you the biology of what we, based on what we know, the importance of stimulation and nurturing, the importance of buffering against stress. Now I'm going to show you what I consider more of a visual image of what it really means. And it's called the still face. And really, I'm showing it for two reasons. One, to give you an idea, which will be part of my later talk, the importance of visual images to get people's attention and to make a point. Two, I want you just to watch behaviorally how children respond to a minor everyday stress. So what you will see in this picture is a mother quickly interacting with her one-year-old. It's a very nice back and forth, the usual kind of interaction that we can see. What I always find interesting, even though it's a baby, babies learn at a very early age to take their turn. So when a mother speaks to the baby or smiles, the baby doesn't, and then the baby takes his turn. So at a very early age, there's that synchrony and there's learning in ways you don't even think about learning. And then the mother is told to not respond to the baby, and you'll see what the baby's responses. And again, this can be normal every day, a mother cooking, a mother on the phone, and we'll talk more about that. And then the most important thing at the end is called the repair. That's one thing I want to emphasize now. During the day, mothers can't always be totally attentive to their children, even though we say that's the advice we give. But they can repair it. Let's say they're cooking or doing something else. So when a baby gets distressed, all a parent has to do to a one-year-old or something is go over and smile and get the baby happy. It reminds the baby, oh, I'm there, I'm okay, my mom's here for me. It's something so simple, it would be like with a six-year-old, after you yell at them, you'd say, you know, I'm sorry I yelled at you, I was in a bad mood. So it's really returning and repairing, getting back. So the fact that you're not there all the time is understandable. It's repairing, it's important. So you'll see all of this on the video. And the last thing I want to mention, there's a point where the baby points and the mother looks. So we're in an era now where we're talking about the 30 million word gap. I assume up in Canada, you all are talking about that too. Yes, the babies need to be exposed to a lot of words. Well, that's true. The original study did show the word gap, but also, in addition to it, there wasn't back and forth communication. So it was not only decreased words, there was no communication, and a lot of the words for the low-income parents were commands. stop that behave, which don't carry information. But more important, if you look at most cultures around the world, people don't talk to babies, almost never. And why? Because babies don't talk. So when we particularly talk to immigrant parents about talking, it could be a tough message. And what do parents do in these countries? They use physical gestures. So when a baby points, the mother looks. That's communication. It's not words, but from the brain point of view, it's very close to the same thing. And that's been going on through history of not preparing babies with words, but communication. There are a couple studies now that show the more a parent does these physical gestures at 18 months, the bigger the vocabulary is, regardless at 5 years, regardless of the number of words. So what I'm adding to you is keep in mind the importance of pointing or baby looks, mother looks, that's communication. It's nice to say something, but you can also reinforce mothers when they do that, that's communication. Because I think we do, in some mothers, pushing a little too hard, talk to your baby, your newborn. I think that's fine, but if a mother's uncomfortable with it or doesn't believe in it, it's not clear to me how well it'll work. But that's a very long introduction to this video. Can we play this, please?
Babies this young are extremely responsive to the emotions, the activity, and the social interaction that they get from the world around them. This is something that we started studying 30, 40 years ago, when people didn't think that infants could engage in social interaction. And it's still phase experiment with the mother baby. She sits down and she's playing with her baby, who's about a year of age. And she gives a greeting to the baby. The baby gives a greeting back to her. This baby starts pointing at different places in the world, and the mother's trying to engage her and play with her. They're working to coordinate their emotions and their intentions, what they want to do in the world. And that's really what the baby is used to. And then we ask the mother to not respond to the baby. The baby very quickly picks up on this. And then she uses all of her abilities to try and get the mother back. She smiles at the mother. She points because she's used to the mother. She points. The baby puts both hands up in front of her and says, "What's happening here?" She makes that screechy sound at the mother, like, "Come on, why aren't we doing this?" Even in this 2 minutes, when they don't get the normal reaction, they react with negative emotions, they turn away, they feel the stress of it, they lose control of their posture because of the stress that they're experiencing. It's a little like the good, the bad, the ugly. The good is the normal stuff that goes on, that we all do with our kids. The bad is when something bad happens, but the infant can overcome it. After all, when you stop the slow phase, the mother and the baby start to play again. The ugly is when you don't give the child any chance to get back to the good. There's no reparation, and they're stuck in that really ugly situation.
So, that hopefully will give you a visual, a metaphor of what the information is. So, how do we communicate these lessons to parents so they can understand it? And what do I mean by understand? I think the key thing is, as you saw there, parents can't always be responsive, but the repair is important. But the other thing I want to emphasize, this is what's made a big point in my thinking these days, is the importance of these visual images to communicate information. I don't know you, but I find this pretty powerful. And when, in the U.S., when we got into the whole brain and baby thing about 20 years ago, and I had been on the Carnegie Commission as part of that, I was asked to go around to state legislatures and talk to them about the importance of babies' brain and, you know, alleged policy issues around childcare. And I use this video because these legislators, I mean, babies have feelings. They can feel. This was totally new information for them. And I think it is probably for, well, intellectually people can say that, but when you see that, you can see the disappointment. The baby has an expectation that when I smile, my mother smiles back. If that expectation is fulfilled, that's again also a cognitive thing. They know this is going to happen. It's a violation, and they get upset. But anyhow, so, you know, what's the use of visual images as we move forward? And that's what I really want to talk about, because partly to scale up interventions, and I'm talking about first tier, we're very people heavy, and actually that's important because relationships matter. But given that I can speak more from the pediatrician's point of view, if we have 15 or 20 minutes every month or two, that's not a whole lot of time. If you're a home visitor, you have a little more time, maybe an hour, you know, whatever that is, either once a week or once a month or even less than that. So how can we extend the amount of time and information in palatable, engageable fashions? And I think, and I don't know whether it'll work, but the media is important. iPhones are important. This generation is on the iPhones. If we're not there, we're not where they are. And when I say that, I want to get away. This isn't about putting pamphlets or text messages. You know, at least in medical settings, we give parents pamphlets. It never makes it out of the office. It's usually in the garbage before they leave. People don't want text. They don't want explanations, usually. So how do we engage them? And all I have to do is remind you of the power of media engagement. When you watch commercials on television, you'll see some nice pictures of a family interaction at a breakfast table or in a living room. You wonder what they're selling. You find out they're selling life insurance. Using these engaging images of families. Or you see a man and a woman driving a car, and they're in love, and it's all nice. What are they selling? They're selling the car. So we have something very important to sell, but we're not taking advantage of both the love and the family to really engage people. We just assume it's there, and then we give the information. I'm going to move over here. Okay. So these are barriers to empathy and hopefulness. I use those words because I don't like serve and return. People use that word to describe the interaction or responsiveness. You know, empathy probably is a core characteristic to keep our world together, that people understand the feelings of someone else and can be responsive. Hopefulness is another core characteristic, and I've started playing around with these different words. These are not the words we use professionally, but these are potentially very important words. And we address things to parents about, particularly empathy, you know, be responsive to the baby, we teach them to play, we do all those things. That's all good. But what are the things that interfere with parents' empathy, with responsiveness, with nurturing? One is depression. You all know about that. Child rearing itself is a risk factor for depression because it's another stress on families. Low-income women can be 40-50% depressed. And this is a diagnosable depression, which is more serious thing, but these are depressed moods. These are people who are overwhelmed. And I won't go into the details now, but I think you all know it. You all know these barriers. The other I want to that people don't know, and I spent a lot of time a year ago learning about this, is mindset. How many of you know the concept of mindset? So a few of you do. So it came from research on adolescents and young adults about their belief about malleability, their ability to learn and to achieve. So if you have a growth mindset, that means that you can do something, that you're going to fail and you're going to work hard. The best example would be athletics, that if a male, say, is shooting baskets for basketball and misses three in a row, he will then take 50 shots before he goes in because he doesn't like missing three in a row. He knows he can do better, he knows he has to practice. What if that same male, 16, 17, gets a C or a D in a math test and says, oh, you know, well, I'm just not good at math. You know, this just reconfirms it. A growth mindset is effort matters and failure is part of it. A fixed mindset is doesn't matter what I do. And the implications actually for parenting is very interesting. There's data that for young children, you praise effort. God, you work really hard. You don't praise intelligence. You don't say you're really smart. If all parents say their kids are really smart, most of them know they're not that smart. And then they're afraid to maybe try new things because they don't want to be found out themselves. So the key is praising effort because that gets the growth mindset to kids. So this is for adolescents. I'm now playing around with a couple of my colleagues. What's a growth mindset for parents? The fixed mindset you probably deal with all the time. A low-income mother says, you know, it doesn't matter what I do, the babies are going to end up saying like me, poor. You know, it doesn't matter what I do. We have to give them a growth mindset that it does matter. Besides showing them that it matters, it's again, the lesson's almost from athletic coaches or music teachers, whatever that cheerleading is, to help people believe they can make a difference. Now, the one thing I became really invested in mindsets is because the interventions are brief, simple, and not expensive. So what they did for the adolescents, and this is all online, they would show an image of a brain lifting weights. Lift weights, the brain got stronger. And they had a couple other images to show work matters. And probably all of you who are here have somewhat of a growth mindset, because you got here because you worked hard. So the question is, how can we, and the studies are clear, parents who have a growth mindset will do more things for their children in a more constructive way because they believe they can make a difference. So I think the challenge for the future is to think about whatever intervention we do, whether it's with play or words or whatever, how do we also include a growth mindset into it? And I'll show you later, but one of the things I'm thinking about are brief videos of testimonies from mothers, how they came to believe that they can make a difference in their child's life. And these would be testimony of mothers just like the audience. So mindset, I think, is important and relatively new to you. To know models about parenting, you know, as I understand.